Hello everyone. Today what we are going to do is Democracy in India Challenges and Solutions. To give you a brief info of this chapter mainly based on the problems that we faced post-independence and till today we are facing. And there are different types of remedies for these problems. And what are these problems actually? These problems are of casteism, regionalism, and racism. Racism is in US, and here we have casteism. We have different names, but this form is same. So there is always communalism and other problems like social inequality. So we will discuss them in a sequence or manners in one or two videos, and then we will just know how can we solve this caste problem. Now this is not a particular topic to be learned or is there in any syllabus as such. But I picked up these topics because you need to know this. Because you see, in today's world, if you don't know the solutions, if you don't know your country well, how will you, you are the leaders of tomorrow. So how we will strengthen our country. So we need to see the perspective of these challenges from various sides, and also to know the world's largest democracy, India, how it was functioning. Now to start with it, India's economy or the social structure after independence were very weak, and it was the part of British colonial legacy. It was a part of this, and so we had a very fragile nature, and our country had undergone partition, and partition also is a main factor which led to communalism. And here communalism, I mean the religion based conflict. Mainly we see this in the Hindus and the Muslim conflict, if we go by the data or the number of cases. Now Hindu Muslim conflict are there, so it is, they are a blot on our democracy. Now our democracy wasn't surviving. There were Nehru years, there are many years and development, and people thought that this is the last time our democracy is there, our democracy will be vanished. But in the Congress system, of the Congress was a previously a movement, the Congress being a very inclusive movement, and they were so they took out some methods in order to help India struggle with these problems and be successful in it. Now they somehow kept the democracy, their processes, they taught people in democracy. Gandhian politics, you know, they are mass politics in nature. They taught people how to cope up with politics, even for the illiterate millions. And also the many leaders, not only of the Congress, but here and there some minor regional parties, they too helped in this feeling. So this feeling was not new to us. It was present before, and we had planned how to make our democracy. We had taken many days and nights, sleepless nights, to build our constitution. This all had provisions for this, for combating these features, these challenges. For combating these challenges, we have the constitution. So we have the remedies here. Okay. Now, democracy in India has the distinction of being successfully functioning and democracy. So our democracy is very successfully functioning. It has two tests, and still the experiment of democracy is going on. It is a evolving process, and it is, our governance system is based on the rule of the people, and these people have been using their political rights. They have been voting, since post independence, and these were given in other countries. If you see, ours is a very diverse country. We have taken our constitution is built up from the inspiration of different countries and not one country. So we have different sources, and no party in our country is dominant. We have a multi-party system, so it saves Indian democracy. And universal adult franchise is not limited to some people, and it has helped to widen the base of power so that the candidates are elected or the leaders are elected directly by the people. And our constitution is both flexible and rigid. Flexible because we can move or make amendments according to the demands of the environment, and demands are always ever changing. We have seen the international politics change, the national politics change. So with that, the constitution needs amendments. Some features had to be there because basic features cannot be amended. Basic features like the rule of law, judicial activism, judicial liberty. I will discuss this in a different chapter, in a different session. So let's move. Parliamentary democracy has been in India since the Constitution of India, 26th January 1950. The founding fathers were aware of this challenge because in the national movement they had somehow confronted with these challenges. Now, the Constitution of India contains several, as I told you, that it contains several procedures for making amendments, and it is a very new type and very liberal type of doctrine. Okay. Now, there are the directive principles of state policy. This helps the state, it directs the state for economic and social transformation in the society for the better. Now, I want to tell you, apart from the constitution, we the people, here we have written this, we the people, that means that the power, that in a democracy, the power, political power is coming from where? The people of India. The people of India are voting people, their leaders, their elected representatives, parliamentarians, whatever you call them, but they are elected in nature, directly or indirectly. And so this our is a, you need to know some basic features. So I'm giving you this knowledge. Sovereign state means we are before the British, under the British rule, our sovereignty was under the British. After we got independence, we were independent in our external and internal decisions. Internal decisions, law and order type, and external foreign affairs. Okay, external, internal freedom is there till today. Okay, we cannot abide by interference by other states. And we are controlling, the people are controlling the government. Now, we are a sovereign state, we are a two secular state, means we do not keep state away from religion. We don't want this interference of religion in states. That is a very dangerous thing, because once a state prefers a particular religion or discriminates based on a religion, the democracy is bound to fall. And so we have a elected representative. So when a person is elected, he has to be responsible, otherwise the next time people won't vote to him. And the responsible and accountable means responsible for its actions. It is the public authority. All the documents and files are subjected to people's view. People can want accountability through RTI 2005, Right to Information Act. I hope you know about this. Now, Indian democracy has four objectives. You know, this is justice, second is justice means solving the inequalities in our society in terms of economic, social and political order. Liberty, there are separate chapters on it. When I will come to it, I will discuss freedom. Now liberty, you think of freedom and freedom with reasonable restrictions, because freedom without reasonable restrictions is nothing valuable. Next is equality means all class of people should be equal, and it doesn't make a classless society. Actually, in other communist countries there is a concept of classless society, but government tries to bridges the gap between rich and poor. This is wealth inequality in terms of. And now fraternity means brotherhood and preserving the dignity and unity of the nation. So there are different ideas on based on there are liberal ideas, socialist ideas, Nehruvian policy, Nehruvian principles and general principles. We would read about them definitely in a separate session. So you see how the chapters are interlinked. So it is important for you to watch all the videos so as to get a complete knowledge of the things working. Now parliamentary democracy is working based on this. I have told you that popular sovereignty, successive governments have been trying to maintain democracy in a way, and India has also become a nuclear power without signing the non-proliferation treaty, and it is a matter of recognition. So India has to be responsible in this handling of the weapons. India's now the main problem, we come the rural infrastructure, the urban infrastructure, though they have improved over the years but not satisfactory. There are many places which remain underdeveloped, and this underdevelopment has caused regional imbalances. You know what is called pocket development. In some places development is there, in some other places development is absent. So we will see how pocket development is caused. What are the gender injustice? I think you have heard to the report that it will take 99 years or something like that to get to gender equality actually. So this is not a global phenomenon. India too faces it. So there are multiple challenges in front of us. Let's move on to the solutions and also the challenges. Okay, then first challenge is the challenge of caste is a social phenomenon. On the screen you can see the caste system of India: Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Sudra, Dalit. So you see, these were the people for whom Gandhiji fought. Although Gandhiji took in his national movement people from different sections of the society, he organized Congress into a mass-based organization. And you see the divisions in our society. Some people still follow them, and it is a social phenomenon. What is actually caste? Caste is a social phenomenon. It is working in the Indian society and has several disadvantages only. It is disadvantageous for the social system in India. And if this, the caste system, we are so dependent on it, then our economic development and political development will have to say tata. Okay, now so we need to integrate our nation. If we think that these things are separate, then it will cause harm to us. We should not divide society, but it doesn't mean we have to lead to a classless society. But yes, we need to remove our prejudices and discriminations that are present in today. Now the rigid rules have been there, and rigid rules for casteism have been there. They vary from state to state. In some states, the states which are economically underdeveloped, people where there is more illiteracy, we get more this type of caste system. There are different reasons which we will go through. And if there is casteism, this group can exploit this easily, this and this again will exploit this. So it is interlinked, and the destruction is caused, and destruction, if he thinks that destruction of the society will fetch him more advantages, yes, for a short while, because if he thinks from the perspective of the society, then it is harmful for both of them in some way or the other. Okay, and there are challenges. Jayaprakash Narayan, you know, the famous politician in our country, Jayaprakash Narayan, he once said that caste has acted almost as a major political party, means it is the biggest political party in India. Why? Because it has been a determinant or mark of politics. It is interfering even politics. How it is interfering, we will see. Now, caste is used by different interest groups for their party politics, for gaining votes for their party, and not only in between this is caused, but people are the sufferers here most. There are riots and the caste violence is very conflicting. So this is a major challenge in Indian democracy. Now, casteism is in Indian politics, so it is interfering with Indian politics. Now, caste and political socialization. First point is the socialization of caste. Different caste groups have their loyalties behind different ideologies, and a person who belongs to scheduled castes or higher castes, in the process of picking off orientations and his beliefs and attitudes are based on his caste. His perception, I told you, his perception is based on that. Narrow perceptions are there. So, narrow perceptions of the people. So, they in the political party take undue advantage of them. So, each party supports one caste and some party support the caste which is in majority so as to gain the vote bank. But in this process, they lead to more tantrums in the society. Now, in the leadership recruitment, if you see in the areas of Haryana, Bihar, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, we have seen that there are some castes who always dominate the political sphere. They are recruited as leaders. First is in the Haryana, it comes from the Brahmins, Haryana Brahmins, and in Andhra Pradesh it comes from the Reddis or Vallamas. So in this way it is present all over the states. Now, caste and party politics. You know, in today we have the BJP, which is ought to be weaponizing Hindutva in order to gain votes. It is said so. It is perceived by the people in this manner. However, differences may exist. So this is an example I can give you. And DMK, Akali Dal is a Jat-based tribal identity. So they are not thinking about the country as a whole, but a particular community. So caste is just embedded in our society, in our beliefs, in our perspectives. Now, role of caste in electoral politics. Now, people belonging from the in constituencies predominated by the Muslims, Muslim candidates are fielded. Means in Muslim community, votes for the Muslim leaders, and in the Jats, in Haryana, Jats are there. So they in which state this Jat is there? In Punjab, we have the Jat. Punjab, they vote for the Jat people only. So this has been a growing trend. We have very few secularist parties who also take undue advantage, because politics is all about power. And there are very few politicians who really think about the development of the country as a whole. Now, caste considerations are given more weightage than and is more appealing to the voters during election campaigns. Now, what is government making? You see, if it enters politics, it would always enter the government making. If the government, supposedly the casteism had played a so important role that a particular caste had become a very powerful and very dominant in decision making, so most of the political parties try to nurture people belonging to scheduled castes as their vote banks. Dalit Brahmin approach has been recently adopted by the BSP. So they use anti-Brahmin campaigns. So if we do not like caste, so this one leader comes and supports the Dalit and says we will lead an anti-Brahmin practice. So this is also not fair, because this is also, we are accepting casteism. We should totally discard it from every section of the society which it is divided, these sections. Okay, now. There is caste in the local politics, there is mobilization of this people, and this people mobilize to form the local self-government, as we know, at local levels. This local government has a leadership role for effective functioning. They take caste, and there are many cases that the sarpanch or is of lower caste and he is made to sit in a floor and not on the chair as others. So this is embedded. However your rank may be, you will have to face caste discrimination more vehemently in some parts of our country. Now caste violence is another thing. Caste, if there is a constant struggle between these castes. A Brahmin does not like the Sudras, Kshatriyas or the Shudras. So we have to, if you see this, they have different functions and we have to perform it together. Then only we can succeed really and perform together for the society, not for our narrow benefits. Okay, and there is always in the Panchayati Raj, so it has entered, there is caste based factionalism or division in our society. In the local government areas it is also seen, though it is elected in nature, still people elect the people who promote casteism. There is a growing tendency because people are illiterate, they have no idea, they are narrow minds. Although some people are there who take always the right decisions, but many of them are a victim of casteism. They are themselves the victim of casteism. Now comes the caste violence. If you say this, there is a constant struggle and it can break to riots. Political riots are most common, and there is a fierce struggle for power in the society. This caste wants to get to power, control the government. Other castes want to get, so there is a severe. He can always murder him. He can murder him. So there is a growing tendency of violence, and it is not acceptable in the land of Gandhiji, who promoted non-violence. So there are many states like Maharashtra, Bihar, Rajasthan, UP, where caste violence is at its extreme position. And caste violence has a major role to play. Now we have heard something called Dalit politics. Now some parties, to gather votes of the Dalits, they go to them and collect their votes by pursuing them. They want to fill their vote banks. Good that if they keep their promises, otherwise they are just fooling them. So there are similar other present these things in different states. Now Indian constitution, I have told you that the Indian constitution is so lengthy that it consists of every feature that is going to help us to undergo through this circumstances. Now, Indian constitution in article 330 and 332, there has been said that the reservation article 330-332, there should be a reservation of seats for the scheduled castes. Reservation is good or bad, we will come to the discussion later, but there is reservation, there is protection for the minorities and the backward classes and their representative reservation where in the union parliament and here in the state legislature. Okay, there is a reservation, there is a special minister in charge for it. Obviously many people doesn't know this, but there is a special minister who looks upon this, the appointment of this backward classes. Now they also, in the Lok Sabha, we have seen the president can appoint two members from the Anglo-Indian community if the president feels that they have not been properly represented, so they can use reservation. There are reservation of jobs, government offices and schools, there are universities both private and public, and this have been put into the constitution. There are various ages or various years for which perhaps the Congress made the casteism made the reservation, which is valid up to 2010, and there are again it is renewed and then it is valid. Now caste is a important role in state politics, especially in states like the Andhra Pradesh, Bihar, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh. Now Bihar, there are some caste groups which I will name. They are Bihar, All India, you can note them down because they are caste groups, they also play an important role in politics. Kayastha Conference, these are caste based organizations. They impact the day to day politics in the states, respective states. In Bihar, Yadavs have also become very active in the Rajput Association. You can remember the easy names like Rajput Association, Yadavs. Now in Bihar politics we have Yadavs dominance. Now there are in Kerala we have the The Nambothiri Brahmins and Nairs, an active groups. If we introduce casteism in politics, they divide the system into Hindu, Christian and Muslim votes. That is not beneficial for our society because development should be all inclusive in nature, taking everyone in the developmental process. And the political life of these states where these casteist organizations are there, there's always based on casteism. In Karnataka we have the Lingayats. Karnataka, see how to remember it. Natak, Karnataka means Natak Karna, and Lingats matlab lingering over something, lingering over drama. You can remember, I am not discriminating anyone, but you can remember this way. There are many caste based organizations. Ukalis are there, Ukal Ligas are in Rajasthan. Jats are there, Gujjars are there, Brahmin caste groups are there. There is a constant struggle of power between Brahmin organization and the anti-Brahmin organization. And there is a need for elimination of this casteism from our country, because our country is based on equality. It is written in our constitution and it needs implementation. You cannot let things go irrationally as they are done by the caste. Caste, I want to say, is an identity mark, but it cannot help you gain undue importance over others. Educational system, if we see, we are teaching the value of equality to students. So that's why education is very important, to dispel the fog of casteism, ignorance of the people. We want to remove it, and we need complete integration of all parties and organizations, all castes. We need all inclusive development, equal development. Okay, and there is a famous judgment in which the verdict is, over the last 110,000 years, the greatest curse that has afflicted the Indian nation had been the curse of casteism. The foreign invaders fully exploited casteism, divided Indian society, and the nation was subjugated. Subjugated means it was suppressed. After the rebirth as a sovereign independent nation, the people of India firmly resolved to secure justice, liberty, equality, and to promote fraternity among the people. And it is the greatest block of the Indian national social integration. And in the new decade, we need to satisfy or fulfill the things that were given in the constitution itself. Castes are anti-national in nature. It is outrightly discarding the presence of any form of caste. So we need to discard this thought and thinking pattern if we wish to become a nation in reality. Casteism had to be totally eliminated. We have to move towards unity, integrity of the nation. We are first Indians. We are not going to identify ourselves based on our castes. We are Indians first. So I hope you could understand the casteism in India. Thank you for watching.